thank you all for joining me at noon today to talk about building an end-to-end secure generative AI application in the cloud. This is a project that a colleague and I, Duan Lightfoot, have spent some time on. We're kind of excited about it because it started out in one direction. We thought this would be great for an ISV audience, and then we realized that anybody can use this if they're building generative AI applications in their organization. So maybe you're a financial organization that wants to have access to customer data to gain context as you use an LLM. You want to do that securely. Or maybe you're a help desk and you want to give context to help desk operators as they chat with the network, the cloud, and try to solve problems. So maybe that's what you're looking for. That's some of the things that you can do with this application. So let me kind of break down how we're going to go through this. We're going to get a baseline, right? We're going to talk about some baseline Gen AI understanding, some of the challenges that we have with it, and then we're going to talk about private link and how it fits. Then we're going to talk about retrieval augmented generation, or RAG. Any of you using that already? Playing around with it, so you know a little bit about RAG. If you don't, I'm going to break it down for you and explain what it does and why it's important for the solution. Then I'll show you the solution, show you a couple of screenshots of the code, and then I'll leave you with some next steps, a workshop that you can go through that'll help you to do generative AI with LangChain, doing RAG, and my contact information so we can keep in touch as you work through projects on your own. I'd love to hear how these things turn out. So, with that said, we all know this generative AI thing, right? It's everybody's talking about it. Every organization has it on the radar right now. But really, what are we talking about when we talk about generative AI and AWS? Well, what we're talking about are foundation models, really, right? And so, what's a foundation model? If you don't have that baseline level of knowledge, I just want to define it, right? These are foundation models that are pre-trained at a certain point in time on vast amounts of unstructured data. It's important to remember that they're trained at a certain time, right? Because anything that happens after that point in time, they don't have information on. Okay, so we're going to come back to that in a little bit. They can be applied to a ton of use cases. And so this is just one, but keep in mind, keep thinking about things that you can do with it. I'm sure you'll find some use cases. And we can customize them. And there's different ways to customize them so that we can get more meaningful output from them. And that's where the RAG piece is going to come in. It's one of the ways that we can do that. And I'll show you the different ways that we have available to us. Now, Amazon Bedrock is basically your gateway into, or your access into, several foundation models, right? So everything from Titan to Jurassic 2 to Claude, Stable Diffusion, right? So this is just a short list, right? This is nowhere near an extensive list. It's just to give you an idea of a few of the foundation models that you have access to through the Bedrock API. Now, when you're interacting with a foundation model, we start to run into some challenges, and people have talked about them publicly. We see it already. One of the first things I think that I was introduced to was model hallucination, right? Model hallucination. We ask a question, the model doesn't know, so it makes something up. And so the information's inaccurate. That's an important thing to remember as we go through the rest of this. The models don't necessarily have domain knowledge. I don't know why it keeps forwarding. I talked about the cutoff date of the training data, and then there are some privacy and security concerns that go along with that as well. They have temporal unawareness. These are the challenges that we deal with. Well, we're going to talk about how we solve that, but you're still going to face it, so I want you to keep that in mind. What does it look like to work with Bedrock? As we build out the solution, what does it look like? Now, what I'm talking about here is the flow of your data, because we want to build a secure end-to-end application. So what's it look like? Okay, so let's get into architecture, right? So Bedrock sits in a service account, okay? And here's your account, or our account, and I just threw a VPC there, and we have a client. Maybe you got the corporate network too, and you got a client there that wants to access that Bedrock service. So what it looks like is there's an API endpoint, and when our client makes a call to the Bedrock API, it goes through our NAT gateway out to that API endpoint. It resolves to a public IP address, okay? That's important. The client, same thing, resolves to a public IP address, goes over the internet, hits that API endpoint. So now we gotta think about, what are we sending over a public network, right? All right, so that's what the Bedrock connectivity looks like. How do we make this connectivity private, right? What can we do so that it doesn't go to a public address? Well, the answer is private link. I said we were gonna talk about that, right? So private link combines a couple of things. It combines VPCs, your virtual private cloud, and software that's delivered as a service, this private connectivity as a service. So what it lets me do is it lets me access a service that's in another VPC. That Bedrock, right, the API that we are accessing, it's in another VPC. It's in that service account, right? So this is going to give us access to it when we establish a private link connection from our VPC to the Bedrock API. The traffic then remains on Amazon's private network. It's customer initiated, so you have to create the private link in your account to connect to the Bedrock API through the private link connection, and you initiate the connectivity out to it. And then when you set this up, it does a mutual handshake, and things are good. So this is what we're going to use to establish that connectivity securely to Bedrock without exposing our traffic to the internet. So what that looks like is this, all right? So we create the private link. The private link establishes to the Bedrock service. It creates an ENI in our VPC. And so whenever the client now resolves that same URL for the Bedrock API, it resolves now to a private IP address, which then is routed over that ENI through private link over to the Bedrock service, okay? So that's done securely. What about that customer, the corporate network? Well now, instead of going out over the internet, we're showing you, you can use Direct Connect into that VPC, and then you can resolve to that same private IP address that'll then traverse the private link. Right, so whether you're trying to get to Bedrock from your corporate network on premises or from within the VPC, you can do it over that private link. So this is great, right? This solves that private connectivity challenge that we have. So now the traffic is secure. But remember this slide? How do we solve this in the application that we are creating, right? How do we solve the problems that we have here or the challenges that we face here? The answer is it depends. It depends. Everybody knows what prompt engineering is. The more information you put into your prompt, the more the LLM can use to give you a response that makes sense. Okay, that's good. But we could use retrieval augmented generation or RAG, or we could fine-tune, or we could train the foundation model from scratch. The further we get to the right, the more complex it gets, the more time it takes, and the more it costs. So the most common method that we see right now is retrieval augmented generation, or RAG. Okay. So what does this mean? So this is where we get into kind of the nitty-gritty. This is the fun stuff. Retrieval fetches relevant content from some external knowledge base. I don't know what is going on with this. Augmentation takes that relevant information and augments our prompt. And then generation, the response from the foundation model is generated based on that additional context that it has. Okay, it's just going to keep scrolling on me, so we'll go. So data ingestion is the first workflow. There's two parts to RAG. So we do data ingestion. So we have our data somewhere, and we pre-process it. Could be a whole bunch of PDFs, all of our data that we want to add context to what we're asking the LLM. So we pre-process it. Then we have to figure out where we're going to put it. So we're going to, for our solution, we put it in S3. So we took all these documents, we put them in S3 after we pre-process them. Then we have to chunk them. What that means is we're going to take those large PDFs, maybe they're all different sizes, and we're going to chunk them up into smaller pieces so that we can more quickly find relevant pieces of data, right? And then we're going to take those chunks and we're going to create embeddings with them. And we're going to use Amazon Titan for our embeddings. All right, so then we put it in. Yep, okay. That one right there. Okay, so just a little further on the embeddings model. So what that means is we take those chunks, we create numerical representations of them, and then we can use those numerical representations to create or to identify similar text, okay, as we search through them. But we're not done with creating the embeddings. We then have to put those embeddings into a vector store. And for our solution, we used Amazon Open Search Serverless. So and there's a couple others listed there that you can put them in, okay? So that's the first part, is getting that relevant data into a vector store. Now, once we've done that, now we go through the text generation workflow. So now you're a user, you ask a question, you are gonna prompt the LLM for something. When that happens, it also creates an embedding, just like we did for the data that we put in the vector store, but this is an embedding where it creates that numerical representation. And when we create this embedding, just like we had done before, we then use it to do a search of that vector store to find similar text, right? So we're looking for that relevant information. Once we've done that, we do that semantic search. Then the context rich data is returned from the vector store. And then that data that we retrieve from the vector store augments the initial prompt, and that is sent to the LLM. So once we send that to the LLM, it has our original question plus all that contextual data from the vector store, and it can now use that to give us a response that's much more meaningful, right? So now we start overcoming those challenges of hallucinations and not having data. A real simplified way of showing you what this looks like is the application. So this is what the application looked like when we didn't use RAG. We had private links set up, but all we did is we just searched the LLM for something that was proprietary to us that the foundation model wasn't trained on. So we created, just to bring it up quickly, a Streamlit app. And I said, what is InfraMind? Has no idea what it is, because we made it up. It's our proprietary representation, or our representation of our proprietary data, right? And it's like, I don't have enough information to tell you what it is. Your query is specific, so I'm not sure what to tell you. So that's without using RAG. And this is why we wanted to use it. So here's what we did. For the data ingestion part, we created an S3 bucket as our source, and we use a gateway endpoint to access it. And we have an event that triggers a Lambda, and the Lambda gets a new document. So the idea is we have a front end, and that front end, we upload a document, and that triggers the Lambda, and the Lambda puts that document in the S3 bucket, right? And we use LangChain to load. That's one of the first parts of RAG. It loads the document, and then it splits it, or it chunks it, Okay, this is after we've put it in that S3 bucket, right? So then LangChain loads it and splits the document into chunks. Then we used Amazon Titan to create the embeddings, and the way that we access Titan through our code is over private link. So we'd already established that private link connectivity. Okay, then it indexes the chunks into Amazon OpenSearch serverless over private link, right? So it puts it into that vector store for us. And at that point, we're ready to go with the data. Now we needed to build the text generation part. So what we did in our code that you can see over there, again, following that same process for our text generation workflow, is we initialize LangChain Bedrock Chat. So if you search for that LangChain Bedrock Chat, it'll take you to the LangChain documentation on how to write that code. Okay? It's also in the code snippet here, and if you follow up with me afterwards, if we connect, I can get you sample code. But we did that over private link, and then from there we initialized LangChain retrieval chain over private link. We asked the question, so we have a function for that. Then we query and retrieve similar documents from OpenSearch, right? So that's that semantic search portion. Then we generate a response from private link, or from Bedrock over private link. Again, end to end, the entire process that we're using is secured over private link. Okay? And then we get an output response from Bedrock. And it's contextually aware, and it's much more accurate. We did it all in Python. We used LangChain, and we were able to bring up a front end that ran on EC2 very easily with Streamlit. And now we get much better data in the output of our chatbot, right? More relevant. Now, this is what our architecture looked like afterwards. So if it was just in a single account, customer account, so we had an ALB that front-ended that EC2 Streamlit web app. We had a private subnet with our Lambda that established a private link in that subnet over to OpenSearch. And that was for the, we used part of that for the ingestion portion and part of it for the retrieval. And then we had a Lambda that over private link talked to Bedrock in that service account. And then if you wanted to take this a step further and look at it from the point of view of a provider, well, at that point, here's your customer account. And as a provider, you could bring up the web app, right, and provide a service to a customer. Customers outside of the AWS cloud can have a TLS connection to your web app and be authenticated, maybe Cognito or something like that, through the ALB. From your subnet in AWS, in your VPC, establish a private link. You'll come in through the NLB of the ISV and then through the ALB to the web app. From there, again, the rest of this looks identical. Your Lambda for OpenSearch query and your Lambda for Bedrock queries. So that was our final architecture that we came up with. And what were some of the key benefits or some of the key takeaways from this? Well, we maintain data privacy and security with private link. We can ensure regulatory compliance with that. And then we really get to unlock the full potential of the LLMs because we're using RAG, right? We unlock that full potential of all of this because we're using the LLM with RAG, and it enhances our accuracy and our efficiency. So that is a lightning talk. There's a couple of resources. This is the private link landing page. That's the Bedrock landing page. That workshop I told you about is the last one, and that is using Bedrock with RAG. I'll leave that there for a second. All right. And then this last one, that QR code will get you connected to me. And if you want some samples of the code, connect with me on whatever platform you want. They're all listed there. And thank you for joining me today. Okay.